morning and welcome to New Hope Church. It's great to have you here today. I want to say thank you to all of you for coming out to just simply be with Tim Rowland today. You could have stopped down the street and hung out with Tim Tebow this morning, all right? But instead, you chose to come and be here. Some of you, now if six of you get up and go out, I'm going to feel really bad, all right? Yeah, there goes my youth pastor, all right? But anyway, great. It's good to have you here today. Boy, what a Sunday last week, huh? Easter Sunday was great. How about for the choir? They did a great job. Man, Randy, and Milo, come here, take a bow. Come here, Randy, come out here. Milo, where's Milo? Take a bow. All right. The dynamic duo of New Hope. Didn't get much time to recognize them last week, but they just did a great job. They've been very generous. They've given all of our vocalists a week off this weekend after all the hard work last week. They also did it because they were afraid that we wouldn't get that projector running again, which, as you were here last week, you know the demise. But if you would turn and look, it is now working. And you can thank Brandon Best for that. All right there on the end. We rented one of those scissor things, and I went up in it, and I said, you know, a younger man ought to do this. That was a real moment of pride dealing with me, all right? You know, yeah, but yeah, that was wisdom. It was, yeah, but I had to swallow my pride and say, okay, this is not for me anymore. But anyway, it's fixed and it works, and we're grateful for that. But glad you're here. If you are a guest today and it's the very first time, or you were here last week, but you weren't at a place where you could grab a communication card, I'd love for you to get a communication card out of the pew. Fill it out. Let us know that you were here. We promise we're not going to annoy you. We're not going to beat on your door or mess with you on the phone, but we're going to send some information through the mail that tells you what goes on around here. It gives you some information about what we believe and the kind of ministries that go on and what you might like to participate in. So we'd love for you to fill that out and let us know. We're going to pan out. I'm going to get to announcements in a minute, but we're going to send out some sign-up sheets, and so we need to bring Eric Olson up before I pass these out, because Eric Olson has a very special announcement, and actually it's an appeal for some of you for service.
Tim said it might be Thursday because it's an 8 o'clock service. I said we needed help on the weekends. But what we need help with is for child care for Celebrate Recovery. We hadn't had it in a couple of years, and the thing about child care with Celebrate Recovery is that we don't want to have it if it's only going to be sporadic. Sometimes we don't have kids show up, and so whoever the child care providers are would just go home on that night. So we wanted to make sure we had it in place. We had somebody step up, and she was doing a great job. She was covering most of it. We had a couple of other people helping out, but she got taken out on the slopes by a snowboarder, and she's waiting surgery right now. So we're trying to put together a team that would be responsible for one Thursday a month. We've got the first Thursday of each month covered. We've got half of the second Thursday and half of the fourth Thursday. So we need six people. The fifth Thursday only comes up four times a year. And then whoever's on the fifth Thursday, we might call on occasionally to back up if somebody else falls in sick. But like I said, we need six people. We've got a family that has started coming. We have child care again. The husband and wife both attend. It'd just be a shame to have to turn people away again. You know, we have people that have attended in the past with kids, and we never know when people are going to show up. It's a shame when they show up, they have kids, and we have to send them away and say, yeah, we don't have child care tonight. They can't attend. So it's an appeal. Hopefully we can get six people to help us out and volunteer for one Thursday a month.
Okay. So you get along with this, you get a free meal, all right? 5:30 is dinner, all right? We have different small groups provide dinner every week, and so the food is good. And if you show up between 5:30, yeah, food is great. That's right, food is great. You get a meal, and then from 6:30 to about 8:30 is the time that you supervise the kids. Eric said in the last service, it's usually between 4 and 6, okay? Really gets over that, and two people can handle that pretty well. If you'd be willing to team up with somebody, please put your name and your contact information, and they will follow with you. One time a month is what they're looking for, so if you can help out, we'd love to have you do it. Also on this sign-up sheet that's coming around, once you get past that, you're going to see one on here that is for Uganda mission trip donations. You'll see more information in your bulletin about this, but Bill and Lindsay are taking a small team of college students to Uganda to be with the Actus family, and these are some supplies they could use there. They will take with them when they go, so if you can help out with those supplies, again, your name and contact information would be helpful, and they'll get you also the correct information or additional update information as is necessary of when those supplies need to be here. And then at the back of the clipboard is there's a new women's Bible study starting on April the 12th. That's just in another, 2 weeks at 6:45. And the theme of this Bible study is called Life Rules. Now, it all depends on how you say that determines the impact of that. If you say life rules, or you can say life rules. I don't know which one is right, Nan. Yeah, I like life rules, all right? So anyway, I think it'll be exciting. The ladies always have a great study, and they would like to know how much material to have ready, so if you would sign up, that would be terrific. So those are the three sign-ups that are coming around to you right now. Let me highlight a few announcements and then updates on some prayer requests here. Yesterday, about 135 of us from New Hope, we met at Maya Theater, and we saw God's Not Dead 2. How many of you are in here and you saw it yesterday? Raise your hand. All right, look around. Hey, was it good? Yeah. Would you see it again? Yes. All right, so guys, if you didn't get to see it with us yesterday, go see it this afternoon or tonight. Opening weekends are really important for these kind of movies in the theater, but if you can't get to it today, see it sometime by next weekend if you could. It is a really, really good movie. It was well done. You might not recognize Pat Boone, but he's in it, okay? He's old. Man. That kind of stunned me, all right? But anyway, it was good. He did a great job. It was a well-done movie. Hope you get a chance to go see it. We had a lot of our high school group that was there, and every report I heard from them was they loved it too, and so that's terrific. 2 weeks from today is our Roundup Sunday. This is actually Big Hat Weekend. This is kickoff to Rodeo Month. I would normally be in my Wranglers and have a big hat on, except I got four things to get to today, and I only wanted to dress once. And so that's why you have me today this way. But anyway, it's 2 weeks from today, Roundup Sunday. That's when the Sharton boys show up, big barbecue pit out front, and we have tri-tip sandwiches. Your elders, all right, and pastoral staff will serve you, and it's always a great meal. There'll be activities for kids out in the grass area. There is going to be a pie-eating contest. That will be worth watching, okay? And then there is, back by popular demand this year, a chili cook-off. All right, we hadn't done that in 2 years, so there was some demand for it. And so it's coming back. If you have a really good chili recipe, make it. Make a pot of it. Bring it. Please take a communication card. If you can, if you're going to enter the chili cooking contest, fill out a communication card with your name, your contact phone number or email, and write on it chili cook-off, because they're going to tell you what time to have it here. We're going to do a little bit differently this year, because in the past, it was always kind of one of the last things we've done. Everybody sampled it, and then everybody had already eaten. And so we had all this really good chili, even the people who were losers, their chili was good. It was. I haven't had a bad bowl of chili here yet. So they're going to work it out so that the chili is tested and the winner is determined before we start, and then we all get to share in the chili, all right? So please fill out that card if you're going to enter the chili cooking contest, Miss Best, okay? All right. Steve said he's taking you down this year, though, on the 8 o'clock service. That's what he said, man. That's what he said. Yes, Nene is a two-time winner, all right? Two-time winner. She needs to be dethroned. All right, Jam Kids. If you have kids from toddler through sixth grade, the next The next study is going to kick off this coming Wednesday evening, so just the middle of this week. They're going to be studying the parables of Jesus, so bring your kids from 7 to 8. It's a great time for them to learn wonderful parts of the Bible. And if you are parents of kids that age, why don't you just hang around for the hour with them? We're offering a very special Bible study called Smart Money, Smart Kids. This is a Dave Ramsey study on finances for parents with young children. And so it'd be a great way just to come and spend an hour here on Wednesday night. Hope Group, they're having a leaders meeting next Sunday afternoon. If you are a Hope Group leader, you need to attend this meeting. It's important for the health of small groups. It's important for assimilation of information to let you know what's going to be happening. We're going to be doing something different in the fall, all right, that we're going to do for a short period of time. You need to be here to get that. If you are a leader and you can't be here, appoint somebody in your small group to be here to represent your group. And here's the deal. You're getting lunch. You're getting lunch. It'll be good. Trust me. It will be good, Corey, right? Okay, all right. Any prime timers in here, 55 or older, notice that a week from Tuesday is your lunch date here at the church. I've already mentioned the Uganda mission. I think that's all the announcements I need to make today. Here's a few prayer requests. Isabel from our 8 o'clock service had her aorta valve replaced on Wednesday. She went home on Friday, and she went grocery shopping yesterday. That's rather amazing to me, man. So, amen. Polly Good from our 8 o'clock service continuing to battle cancer. This is the third time it's been back. It's a little harder this time than it's been in the past. Please be praying for Polly. If you know her, if you're acquainted with her, give her a call and encourage her. I know she would appreciate that so very much. You'll see a prayer request listed in here today for Renee Shaw's dad. You can change that. You can now pray for Renee Shaw's family because Renee Shaw's dad doesn't need our prayers anymore. He's in heaven today. At 4 o'clock on Friday afternoon, he was under Nancy Hines Hospice Care in their home, and very peacefully he went home to be with the Lord. That service is going to be on Friday, right? Okay, we haven't determined time yet. Okay, but so we'll get an email out and let you know. so just please be in prayer for that family. Also from our church family, Rhonda Davis, Tasha Gray, part of our church from time to time, their mother and grandmother, they were uncertain about where her relationship with Jesus was, so they called on Thursday, asked if I could come by. Went by Thursday afternoon, had a wonderful visit with her, and she prayed to receive Christ. We had a great, great time. It was wonderful. And yeah, that was good news. That's worth clapping over. And their daughter Rhonda asked me after we went out into the living room, she had some questions, and she said, when should I tell her it's okay for her to go? I said, today. She said, really? I said, yeah. She said, well, that means she'll go. I said, doesn't mean she'll go today, but she's at peace. You know that. It's okay. And I said, and don't be surprised. She has peace in her heart now. Don't be surprised if it comes sooner rather than later. I can't tell you how many times I've seen that. And at 8 a.m. the next morning, she went home to be with the Lord. And so we rejoice over that. And that service will be here on Thursday. So please be in prayer for both of these families. And you will probably be getting calls or emails from Nancy. We're probably going to be needing help, all right, for both of those days. So thank you for your availability to help with one or both of those. And then continue to pray for those families that we have ministered to in recent weeks here at New Hope. So I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward, wait on us today as we have our morning tithes and offering. Gentlemen, would you come, please? Let's pray. Father, for the life you share with us, we are so grateful. For the needs that we face in life, we can't imagine what it would be like to face those challenges without your sufficiency available to us. Father, we sang in the 8 o'clock service that you are an awesome God. You are so awesome that you are beyond our imagination. You are so awesome. You are beyond our ability to comprehend. You are so awesome that we can't figure out all there is to know about you. And I guess that's why you're God and we're not. And so, Father, I'm so grateful that you love us so much, that you sent your Son, the Lord Jesus, to die for us, and that he loved us so much he was willing to die on a cross for us. But Father, that is not where your love stopped. Your love continued, and you raised him from the dead so that we can now share his life in us every moment of every day. But Father, you're a perfect gentleman. You don't invade our life because we're born in America. You don't intrude in our life because we pop into church on a particular Sunday. Father, you only come to take up residence within our lives when we open up the door of our heart and say, Lord Jesus, I want a relationship with you. We don't marry into a relationship. We're not birthed into a relationship. We simply must choose a relationship with you, and the privilege of choosing that relationship today if we never have before. For the privilege of giving and sharing, we say thank you today. We do so as a generous response to your hilarious love for us. We commit all this to you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. I am not quite sure what it is about that particular song that moves me unlike any other song. It did that to me the very first time I heard it in Africa, and it did it to me again today. None of us want to admit that we are afraid of anything. And yet it is only found in the liberty that is ours in Jesus Christ that we can say we're not a slave to fear anymore. We may not like some things, but we don't have to be afraid of things anymore. And boy, I don't want our lives to be governed and our decisions shaped and made by the things that create fear in us. I want them to be shaped by the faith that saved us. I invite you to find Psalm 26. It's where we're going to spend most of our time this morning. I did a brief experiment in the 8 o'clock service, and I still got out on time. So I'm probably going to do the experiment in here again. It's not an experiment now. But Psalm 26 is where we're going to be. If you're new to New Hope, we're jumping back in after a little break in Easter. We're jumping back into the series that we started at the beginning of the year. It's called The Less, More Lifestyle. This is a year-long sermon series. Boy, we are being told in pastors' magazines and preaching tools that we get on the internet that you better keep your sermon series to 4 to 6 weeks because that's as long as the attention span of your congregations are. A lot of pastors must preach to a lot of dumb people, okay? Because I'm telling them that's not true at New Hope, okay? You guys are a lot smarter than that. Or I'm a lot dumber than that, and I don't know enough to shorten them, all right? But we're going to be in this series all year, and I hope as a result the truth is in us for a lifetime. Because the truth is a less, more lifestyle. We kicked it off in January when we're thinking about less weight, more shape, less debt, more savings, those kind of things. And we're translating that into our spiritual realm, less of me, more of him. Less of Tim, more of Christ. And you put your name in, less of you, more of Christ. And there are four steps in that process for that to become real in our life. And we want to have a close examination in December of where have we come since January. Or if you've plugged in April, okay, where have I come since April till now? Where is that true in my life? And there's four steps to the process. First one is choice. Second one is consistency. It's not a once and done choice. I must make that choice every day. In order to maintain that daily choice, there must be accountability. I have never done Weight Watchers, all right, but I've had family who has, and I understand one of the big components of Weight Watchers is on the same day, at the same time, you show up at their facility and you stand on a scale and look down. There's your accountability, okay? And so at the end of this year and throughout the year, we're going to stand on the scale and we are going to look down. And we are going to find out where we've grown in this arena of less of me and more of him. And then the fourth process, step in the process, contemplation, the word we know the least about out of all of those words. And it's why we chose the psalm for our study for this year, because the psalms naturally bring us to this place, or should bring us if we allow them, to this place of contemplation. Contemplation is the slow, deliberate thinking, meditating on the truth of God's word, even discovering if it is true, if you have doubts. And so contemplation is the key, and that's why we are in the psalm. We're not going to get through all of them, but we'll get through about 40 of them before this year is over. And we find ourselves today in Psalm 26. However, It's not often in the Psalms that one psalm kind of connects to the next. It's kind of like this is the Bible's hymn book. And so just as in the hymn book, which we don't sing from anymore, but if you would like to familiar yourself with one, there's one or two in every pew. You could take a look so you know what I'm talking about. But often the songs don't always go in the same theme or the same order, one right after the other. They're freestanding. And that's often true with the songs in the book of Psalms. But sometimes you will find a connectedness from one psalm to the next. And I think that's true in Psalm 25 and 26. Just a brief bit of background. David, as a boy, was anointed the next king of Israel. He didn't know when his inauguration date was going to be. What he did know is it wouldn't be until Saul, the current king, died. Saul, who was the current king of Israel, had done evil in the eyes of the Lord. He had betrayed his faith in God. And as a result, God said, the kingship will not follow to your son Jonathan. I am removing the kingly family from your family and I'm placing it on another. And that other was David. Saul continued to live for many more years, and Saul increasingly became jealous of David. And he literally tried to kill David on numerous occasions. David had to run and hide in the wilderness, in caves. There was one time in which Saul, this is kind of weird, this is in the Bible. I'm not making this up. Saul had to go to the bathroom. And so Saul snuck into a cave to go to the bathroom. I'm dressing this up a little, okay? And while he's doing his business in the cave, he had no idea that the cave he was doing his business in was the cave that David was hiding in. And David reached up and just cut a little piece off of the end of his garment. And after Saul left the cave and got a little ways away, David stood up and said, Saul, I could have taken your life, but I didn't, because I won't raise my hand to God's anointed. You've been anointed to serve as king until God says, time is up, and I'll be patient and wait. Imagine that. He's for years, if not a decade and a half, he's waiting to become king, and he's hiding in a cave. He was treated badly. I am confident that loneliness must have set in. And that's where I want to jump into the last part of chapter 25 before we launch into 26 today. Follow along with me beginning at verse 16. Notice what David says to God when he talks to him, when he sings to him. He says, turn to me and be gracious to me. Notice the admission of a man who's going to be king. For I am lonely and afflicted. I suspect if I were to take a show of hands, that every one of us in this room at some season in our life have experienced loneliness. I've been there. And I'm confident you have too. And it's not a pleasant place. David said, I'm there. And I'm afflicted. The troubles of my heart have multiplied. It seems like when you are lonely, your troubles get bigger and become plentiful. Free me from my anguish. Look upon my affliction and my distress and take away all of my sins. Here's a little secret, guys. The first key to overcoming loneliness is confession. The first key to overcoming loneliness is confession. Others may have some responsibility in our loneliness, but David is indicating something here that he's contributed a part of it. And he said, I need to admit it. He goes on to say, see how my enemies have increased and how fiercely they hate me. Guard my life and rescue me and let me not be put to shame, for I take refuge in you. Here's the second step. Starts with confession and then the next step is commitment. God, I'm going to realize nobody else may want to have anything to do with me, but I'm not alone. I take my refuge in you. And with you, I don't have to be lonely. May integrity and uprightness protect me because my hope is in you. Sounds like a song we sing around here from time to time. My hope is in you, Lord. My hope is in you. Redeem Israel, O God, from all their troubles. Notice, once he finally confessed and made a commitment, he got his eyes off himself, and now he started looking at the needs of others. It's amazing how that takes place. You see, loneliness is debilitating. Loneliness is a disease to our heart, and it multiplies our afflictions. Loneliness is a disaster to our minds, and it causes us to imagine things that really aren't even there. And loneliness is debilitating to our family life, to our social life, to our professional life. Loneliness. David says, there is an answer. Confess and commit. We're going to jump into chapter 26 now. That didn't take too long. That was the pre-sermon to the real sermon today, all right? All right, and just before we get to chapter 26, there's a term. Actually, what I've entitled this sermon, if I put a title to it today, it's called Psalm 26, A Song of Divine Scrutiny. What David's going to do in this psalm is he is going to throw his life open and say, okay, God, examine me. When you go to a doctor for your 40-year-old or your 50-year-old or your 60-year-old examination, is the doctor examining you for his benefit? No, he's examining you for your benefit, not his. And sometimes, let's be honest, those examinations are not pleasant. I so happen to have a doctor who I went to high school with. He's 6'5" and he can palm a basketball. I wished I had found a much smaller doctor when I went for my examination. Yeah. Those of you laughing, exactly what I'm talking about right here. But he did not do that for his benefit. He did that to reveal to me for my benefit what my health is. Okay? And the same thing is true with David in this situation. He is not opening himself up to God's scrutiny in his life so that it would benefit God, as if God didn't already know what was going on inside of David's life. He opens himself up so that God can let him know what the reality of his life is. That's kind of, man, when we think something's wrong with us, have you ever known people who refuse to go to the doctor when they know something's wrong because they don't want to know? They know something's wrong, but they don't want to know. Figure that one out. And we do that with God a lot. So with that in mind, let me take you back to a word that's found in the New Testament. And it's a Greek word, and when it's translated, its literal translation, I think, goes something like this: to be judged in the sunlight. Scrutiny literally means to be judged in the sunlight. And then we have our English word that we often use, and we translate either scrutiny or sincere. We use a word in the English that comes from a Latin derivative, which means, and get this was very confusing to me initially, it means without wax. Usually I figure out the connections pretty quickly, you know, from another language into English, but here we have judged in the sunlight, and then we have without wax. Thank God for Google. Here's the background of this. In the days when art flourished in ancient Greece, it was the common practice to repair artistic work with invisible wax. They would take a vase or a statue that, as a result of carelessness or misadventure, had been damaged, and they would repair it with invisible wax. A rich man or a person of high rank might employ a sculptor to chisel his bust out of marble, and sometimes, if the chisel slipped, the nose would fall off. Rather than go to the trouble of making a whole new bust, the sculptor would mend the features with invisible wax, and the flaws could not be detected except under very close scrutiny. And the sculptor could palm off on the customer his defective workmanship. If the client happened to be a knowing person, he would carry the finished statuette out of the studio, out into the open sunlight before paying for it, and he would examine it very carefully. Otherwise, in the course of time, he would have the chagrin of seeing the nose drop off of his statuette in the warmth of his home. The statue was not sincere, not without wax, and could not bear careful scrutiny in the sunlight. Fascinating, isn't it? Now here's the question. Can we? Wonder how much invisible wax we have camouflaging the damage and the flaws in our own life. Chuck Swindoll said, if I were to give to Psalm 26 a popular title, the title for this song would be How to Do Right When You've Been Done Wrong. That's a country tune, isn't it? Yeah. And I will ask you to raise your hands. How many of you have ever been done wrong in your life by somebody? Okay, yeah. Another question. You don't have to raise your hand on this one. How many of you have done somebody wrong? Could probably be just as unanimous, I suspect. Whatever the mistreatment we have had to endure or whatever treatment we might be currently enduring, please accept this dual warning this morning. Number one, don't become bitter. Number two, don't let it undermine your relationship with God. In the opening line of Psalm 26, let's just read the chapter. He says, vindicate me, O Lord, for I have led a blameless life. I have trusted in the Lord without wavering. Test me, O Lord, and try me. Examine my heart and my mind. Test me, try me, examine me. For your love is ever before me, and I walk continually in your truth. I do not sit with deceitful men, nor do I consort with hypocrites. I abhor the assembly of evildoers, and I refuse to sit with the wicked. I wash my hands in innocence, and I go about your altar, O Lord. I proclaim aloud your praise, and I tell of all of your wonderful deeds. I love the house where you live, O Lord, and the place where your glory dwells. Do not take away my soul along with sinners or my life with bloodthirsty men, in whose hands are wicked schemes and whose right hands are full of bribes. But I lead a blameless life. Redeem me. Be merciful to me. My feet stand on level ground. In the great assembly, I will praise the Lord. In 1 Samuel chapter 13, it's what I referenced at the very outset of when Saul was anointed king and lost his right for the lineage to stay in him. I want to read to you what God told Samuel to say to Saul at that moment. It's important before we start 26. You acted foolishly, Samuel said to Saul. You have not kept the command the Lord your God gave you, and if you had, he would have established your kingdom over Israel for all time. But now your kingdom will not endure. The Lord has sought out a man after his own heart, and he has appointed him leader of his people. Samuel said to Saul on behalf of God, God said, I've been looking for a man who's got a heart for me. What are the characteristics of a person who has a heart for God? I think these 12 verses give us 12 characteristics. We're not going to spend much time on any one of them, but we are going to look at all of them. Number one. In verse 1, the very first line, in fact, let me just read the first verse slowly again. Get the sense of the emotions maybe behind David as he writes this entire song. David says, vindicate me, O Lord, for I have walked in my integrity in a life that is blameless, and I have trusted in the Lord without wavering. No slipping, no sliding. First thing we'll notice about a heart that is after God's is they are confident in the Lord's judgment. Notice in this verse that the man who seeks after God's own heart is ready for the Lord's scrutiny and judgment. Only the guilty and the corrupt should fear God's exposure and judgment of their sins. If you go just a few pages to your right and you find the book of Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon. Ecclesiastes was written by the son of David, who followed David as king over Israel. His name was Solomon. He was a brilliant man, very wise. If you read the book of Ecclesiastes, you'll also find there were seasons in his life in which he was very discouraged. There were seasons in his life in which he was very lonely. Now, that's hard for me to get my head around when you understand how many wives and concubines Solomon had. But yet, when you read Ecclesiastes, you'll discover he had those seasons in his life. And I want you to notice how he writes the concluding verse of the book of Ecclesiastes, the very last verse. This is what he writes. For God will bring every deed into judgment, including every hidden thing, whether it is good or whether it is evil. And if you flip on over to the New Testament, just so you know, this is not only an Old Testament principle. Paul wrote in the book of Romans, chapter 2, verse 16, he wrote these words. This will take place on the day when God will judge men's secrets through Jesus Christ, as my gospel declares. David is saying, Lord, I don't want to wait to the end of my life for you to examine me and see what's going on inside of my life. I don't want to wait, God, until I'm king over Israel. I want to know right now, in a cave, in a wilderness, while I'm on the run, I want you to tell me what's my life like. That's a characteristic, a key characteristic of any person who has a heart for God. God, here I am, I'm yours. The second thing that we'll notice, the second characteristic about a person who has a heart for God is they put their trust in the Lord as their God. Notice it's not just I have trusted, but I have trusted in the Lord. Very specific. Trust is only as effective as the source of what you're putting your trust in. If you put your trust solely in science, the science has to be reliable. If you put your trust in technology, and how many times has this let you down? Some of you tried to find your way to New Hope Church the first time by using technology, and you ended up at Clovis Community Hospital. Okay? Technology is not perfect. It's only as good as the source. David said, the source of my trust is the Lord. This is full and complete trust. This is not just lip service. This is a trust that leads to life service that is filled with the love of God, with all of his heart, with all of his soul, with all of his mind, with all of his strength. The third characteristic you'll find of a person who has a heart after God's is they guard themselves against backsliding. That's what he said. I will not slip. I have a blameless life without wavering. No slipping, no sliding. As most of you know, I was raised Baptist. There's about 40 branches of Baptists. I was raised in a denomination called Free Will Baptist. Gave me some incredible opportunities and taught me an awful lot as a solid foundation of what I grew up with. One of the characteristics of Free Will Baptist and of a lot of Baptist groups as well is they like to preach a lot on backsliding. Okay, it's one way pastor could keep people coming to the altar. Okay, my grandfather McLean one time said to a friend of his who preached on backsliding so often, he said, "You preach on backsliding so often, I think I need to practice it." And it's the idea that, okay, I'm going to slip back. Well, we don't have to slip back. And David tells us here, all right, I want to guard against slipping backwards. There is no wavering in my trust in you. How do we guard today in 21st century culture? How do we guard against not slipping and sliding backwards? May I suggest to you, it first of all starts with this. It starts with becoming men and women and young people. All right? And we got some high school students, got some college students all sitting right here. Guy, you don't have to wait until you're as old as I am to fall in love with this book. When you're in first grade and they give you a reading book, you don't take that book to second grade. They give you new ones. Same thing was third grade and 12th grade. This is a book that I give to you for the rest of your life. This is a book that will never, ever end being a source of value and growth in your life. And you can't read it once and say, once and done. This is a book you read again. This is a book that's it's like a well that is so deep. It will take, remember the movie? No, some of you don't. To the Center of the Earth. Remember that movie? Journey to the Center of the Earth. The first one was so bad. It was so bad. All right, second one got a little better. I think the third one was probably better yet. But anyway, man, it's deeper and deeper and deeper. This will get you to the center and heart of God. But it's a journey. And this is what keeps us from slipping and sliding in whatever culture that we're being raised in. And then the next step besides Bible reading is in praying. And I'm one of those odd ducks. I think you ought to read first, then pray. A lot of guys will tell you, pray, then read. Well, what often happens is people pray, and they pray so long they never get to reading. And they don't realize that they're probably praying. I always get in trouble when I say this. They're praying badly. The Bible ought to be that which directs our prayers rather than us directing God from our own thoughts. So read, pray. And okay, if you want to pray first, say, Lord, help me understand what I'm reading. Amen. And then read and then pray. Okay? That would be all right. But I have this fear that people choose to pray more than they read God's word because it's easier to talk than it is to read. And it might be why that the church is often so anemic is because we pray a lot, but we don't study a lot. I didn't say that in the 8 o'clock service. Then we maintain fellowship with others. We're students of the book. We call it church. The Bible says don't forsake this gathering together. It's necessary. It's important. It helps combat loneliness. And yet when we feel lonely, where do we avoid? We avoid church. We avoid small group. We avoid fellowship. I'm not feeling good. Well, what's wrong? Well, I'm lonely. Figure that one out. I'm lonely, so I'm going to stay home. And then if we're studying the scriptures, and if we're praying, and if we're hanging out with others who are studying the scriptures and praying, then we will find and do God's will. Those are the steps against sliding backwards. Number four, those who have a heart for God desire to be examined by the Lord. This one, this is the one that kind of blew me away. And I said, well, wow. Because I got to be honest, I'm not sure I've ever willfully thought about, okay, God, examine me. Just, okay, God, here I am. Buck naked, I'm yours, man. Show me my flaws. Here's what I think is key. David says here, I've led a blameless life. I've trusted without wavering. And then he says, but test me, examine me, and try me. And then he gets on down here and he says, but I lead a blameless life, but redeem me and be merciful to me. David says, from my end of things, I look pretty good. But God, from your end of things, I may not look so good. So be merciful with me. You see, I think you and I need to know God well enough that we know that just because He judges us doesn't mean He doesn't love us. And the only reason He judges us is so that we can give Him permission to perfect us, to eliminate those things that are problematic in my life. We don't see them as problems. He does. We say, Lord, show me. He does. And we're afraid. We think that what God wants to do is slap us down. When that's the last thing He wants to do, what He wants to do is He wants to lift us up. But we got to know God in such a way that we can say, Lord, I want you to examine my life. The man who seeks after God's own heart does not fear the Lord's judgment, and we are not afraid of the examination results that he will find. That's why David uses three different words. Test me, try me, examine me, test me, look at my will and my motives, try me, treat me like you do silver that you're refining into perfection, and examine my mind and my heart. In other words, God, know my innermost thoughts and my innermost feelings. Those things that I cover up and I hide from everybody else. I can't hide them from you, God, but I've hidden them even from me. So now reveal those to me. Three different Hebrew words, each more intense than the other. And the purpose was not so God would know David's heart, but it was so that David would know David's heart. Are you willing to have God look deep inside your heart and reveal to you your attitudes, your rebellions, your iniquities? And if you do, are you willing to confess and forsake them to obtain mercy? Listen to what the wise man wrote in the book of Proverbs 28:13. The one who conceals their sins does not prosper, but whoever confesses and renounces them finds mercy. That's why David didn't mind saying, God, check me out. Why? Because you will be merciful to me. Number five, the one who has a heart after God remembers the Lord's loving kindness. The man who seeks after God's own heart is aware of God's goodness, mercy, and grace. Romans 8:28, God works all things together. He doesn't work all good things together. He works all things together for good to those who will love God and trust Him. You see, when you are being mistreated, that is the moment we cannot doubt God's love. In the moment of mistreatment, do not doubt the fact that God loves you. Who was the most mistreated person who ever walked the face of the earth? You and I should not doubt God's love when we are being mistreated by others. Number six, those who have a heart after God, they walk according to God's word. How do they do that? They read it, they believe it, they study it, they contemplate it, they obey it. And when you are being mistreated, don't disobey God's word. When you're being mistreated, don't doubt God's love. And when you're being mistreated, don't disobey God's truth. The Bible is the only thing on this earth that possesses the attributes of God Himself. For the Word is holy, and the Word is eternal, and the Word is perfect, and the Word is good, and the Word gives us light, and the Word saves us, and the Word sanctifies us. The Bible will judge all men according to Jesus in John chapter 12, verse 48. It is the truth of Scripture that will judge all men. Number seven, those who have a heart after God separate themselves from ungodly influence, as illustrated in verses 4 and 5. When you are being mistreated, you can always find a group of people to take your side, to encourage your thoughts, to challenge you to seek revenge, and they will give you a lot of bad advice. Do you remember misery loves what? You'll find it. You'll find it. But notice what David said. David, in his misery and his loneliness, said, there are some things I will not do. There are some places I will not sit, because if I sit there very long, they will influence me. And David said, I will not sit with four particular types of people. It really parallels what he wrote in Psalm 1. All right, but here he says it slightly differently. He says, first of all, I will not sit with deceitful people, for they cannot contribute to spiritual growth. They are spiritually bankrupt. I will not sit with deceitful people. Number two, I will not sit with hypocrites. Folks who pretend while hiding some corrupt agenda. Number three, I will not sit with evildoers, those who willfully enjoy and promote sin shamelessly. Number four, I will not sit with the wicked ones, ever guilty with no signs of repentance in their life. I don't think any of us could ever run for the Senate or Congress if we're going to not do any of these things. Okay, I thought that was kind of funny. Maybe it was too truthful, all right, to be funny. 1 Corinthians 15:33 says this, do not be misled, bad company corrupts good character. And David said, I will not sit in bad company. Number eight, those who have a heart after God offer sacrifices. When one enters the temple to offer sacrifices, you had to, in the Old Testament days, you had to stop at the giant laver to wash your hands, signifying purity. We must offer to God a pure living sacrifice, according to Romans 12:1. I present my body as a living sacrifice that is now wholly acceptable unto God. David was concerned during this time in his life that his heart remain right. So he used this phraseology that said, I'm washing my hands at the laver before I offer my life, and I am staying near the altar. And the challenge to us, if we want a heart after God's, is keep a clean heart and a right attitude. Number nine, those who have a heart after God testify of God's work. That's found in verse 7, which says, proclaiming aloud your praise and telling of all of your wonderful deeds. They simply tell what God has done in their life. This is an attitude, bless you, an attitude of thanksgiving. Now, that was a great line in the movie, by the way, God's Not Dead, all right? That was a great line, so watch for that. Watch for the sneezing person in God's Not Dead, all right? It's in the courtroom, all right? In the courtroom. It was great. It was great. No, that's okay. We'll get back on track here. This is not David bragging about himself. This is David resting in God's provision in his life. Psalm 89:1 is a parallel passage to this, and it reads like this. I will sing of the Lord's great love forever. With my mouth, I will make your faithfulness known through all generations. And guess what? Because we're talking about it today, it's living proof that he fulfilled that prophecy. He is making known to this generation what he discovered generations ago. Number 10, those who have a heart after God, they love the house of God. Verse 8. Did you notice it there? Verse 8. I love the house where you live, O Lord, the place where your glory dwells. They attend it, they pray for it, they support it, they love it, because the honor of the Lord is to be found in the house of the Lord. Number 11, those who have a heart for God walk in integrity. They walk with a desire for blamelessness. Integrity is the quality of having strong moral and spiritual principles, honesty, righteousness, goodness. What you can find in Galatians chapter 5 is the fruit of the Spirit, the result of a life walking with Christ, as opposed to the character of those who are sinners, murderers, troublemakers, bribers, corrupt men, society's plague, the deceitful people, the hypocrites, the evildoers, and the wicked one. And number 12, they are in the right place, and they bless the Lord. Notice verse 12, he stands in the even place. This suggests my favorite word in the English language, balance. When I got on that scissor lift, I was up there once. And I was on an even place. But 20 feet off the ground, it sways. The farther we get away from solid ground, the farther we get away from solid truth, things begin to sway, and it gets more dangerous for us. Are you walking in a solid place? These are the characteristics of a person who seeks after God's own heart. I don't know about you, but I got to tell you, after the study this week, this is the kind of person I want to be and to become. Without confidence in God, we would never sing this song out loud. If we don't have confidence, we need to sing this song out loud. David was confident that his heart and motives were right, but he was not afraid to be examined by God and proved wrong. He believed his heart was right, but he knew God's mercy was righteous. And God wants to give to you and me his mercy. David knew he could pass the test because he had kept his love for God. David knew he could pass the test because he had a desire to walk in paths of righteousness. David knew that he could pass the test because he had kept away from those who would lift his heart in pride and have him seek revenge. David knew that he could pass the test because he had not listened to the voices of men in his own ranks who encouraged him to destroy Saul and take what God had already promised to him anyway. David knew he could pass the test because he would not listen to those voices who would bring war and strife and disunity in the nation of Israel. David knew he would pass the test because he hated sin in all of its form, even in his own life when exposed to him. He hated it as well. David knew he would pass the test because he would not listen to the advice of those who were not right with God, no matter how logical or reasonable their counsel may have been. So how do we prepare ourselves for God's test? We must keep ourselves unspotted as much as possible from the sin around us. We should walk in holiness and sanctification of Christ. We must not allow pride to rise up within our hearts and convince us that we have the right to cause division and disruption within God's people. We must not allow Satan to convince us that we need to hear the voice of reason above the voice of God in telling us to love one another and keep the unity of the fellowship. Satan loves to sow discord. Satan loves to disrupt God's unity in our lives. You and I should not pull our own reins, but we should do what the Lord wants us to do. Let me wrap this up. I gave you 12 points. That gets a little lengthy. I was quick, huh? I'm out of here. Okay? Let me give you 6 that summarize the 12. Here they are, real quick. Be it resolved, I will be open before the Lord. Be it resolved, I will remember His love and obey His word. Be it resolved, I will refuse the temptation to get even or get back. Be it resolved, I will maintain a healthy attitude. Be it resolved, I will be faithful in worship publicly. 6, be it resolved, I will patiently stand and wait for relief. It's not always instant. David had to wait years. Sometimes it's the little things, it's the maybes that serve to shape our character the most. I will wrap this up with a quote from F.B. Meyer, a brilliant pastor and theologian from about 3 generations ago. Here's what he wrote. The supreme test of goodness is not in the greater, but in the smaller incidents of our character and practice. It's not what we are when we're standing in the searchlight of public scrutiny, but it's who we are when we reach the firelight flicker of our homes. Not what we are when some clarion call rings through the air, summoning us to fight for life and liberty, but it is our attitude when we are called to early morning sentry duty. When the watchfire is burning low, it is impossible to be our best at the supreme moments of life if character is being corroded and eaten into by daily inconsistency, unfaithfulness, and sin. I wonder how many of us might be willing to go home today and sing this psalm personally. Vindicate me, O Lord, I walk blamelessly with you. Try me, test me, and examine me, and be merciful to me, O Lord. Let's pray. Father, you did some amazing things in David's life, and David was amazing that he let you. I've always found great comfort in knowing that David wasn't perfect, and yet he could still have a heart for you. So that offers us in our imperfections today, it offers us hope. It offers us hope, Lord, that you can continue to do in us what you did in David. It also offers us hope, Father, that others who desire to be like you will not give up on us, and we do not have to give up on them, because our hope is in you, O Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a great afternoon.